Let's all give them a round of applause. And keep that going for singing of our national anthem by Ms. Stefana Sneed. Well, welcome. My name is Isaiah Anderson, Jr. Yeah, you can go and have a seat for a little minute. And I am a 25-year employee of the City of Seattle's Department of Parks and Recreation and a resident of Seattle, Washington for 30 years, born and raised in Chicago, Illinois. I came here to visit, and I've been visiting ever since. So this is a beautiful thing. We are here to celebrate, and I want y'all to hear this, the first annual. Hold on, don't clap. I want you, need you to sink in. We are the County of King, are we not? And we are celebrating our first annual City of Seattle MLK celebration. Now you can clap. So we welcome you all. We thank you for coming down here to City Hall. It is my honor to be your MC for this afternoon's program. Let's give a round of applause for everybody who participated in the exhibits, the DJ, the food. I know some of y'all didn't get the food. I didn't. So you don't want to clap because you didn't get it? Is that what it is? Let's clap for the food anyway, because I heard it was a lot of it. I heard, Bruce, Councilman Harrell, I heard there was a lot of food. When I got here, it was magically gone. But we're going to have a good time anyway. It is my pleasure now to present to you the young lady who you just heard singing our national anthem. I'm just going to share real quick. I worked at Langston Hughes Performing Arts Center for 19 years, and 13 of those years I was just blessed to be the director of the All-City Teen Summer Musical, where we performed at the Paramount Theater, the Seattle Rep, and more. And this young lady was our very first star, if you will, in the production we did of The Wiz. She was Dorothy. And so now, years later, she's still blessing us with her voice. So if you can all please stand again as she will sing for us the Black National Anthem.
Keep us forever.
I'd like to take credit for that, but I can't. You can be seated. I really would like to take credit for that, but she has two awesome parents who are here, Vita and Steve. Thank you all so much for sharing her. So next time she'll get a little dramatic, you know, something, reaching for something. You know, she didn't this time because we didn't talk about it. We are now going to have words of encouragement, if you will. Words of welcome, let's say that. Words of welcome, is that all right? Words of welcome. We'd like to thank all of our elected officials. We'd like to thank our police department, our fire department, and those of you who are here. All the employees and members of this city who just came out to celebrate with us. We thank you, we know. You know, to take time off now on your job is time off. Don't worry about it. You work that out on your time sheets. But we thank you for coming out, and now we're going to have these words, and we're going to have first up, we are going to have our own mayor. And as he stands, I'd also like to for all of you to know that the first gentleman is joining him. So both of you please stand. Our own Mayor Ed Murray, if you can come up.
Well, thank you. And I do want to, I know you were clapping for the first gentleman, so thank you. So thank you for doing that. This has been a difficult period in our nation's history, and it's been a difficult period in our city's history. But as Dr. King pointed out again and again, it is through these difficult times that hope becomes a reality. And so as we celebrate over the next several days the memory of Dr. Martin Luther King and the ongoing work of his dream, I hope we keep in mind that despite the difficulties, as Dr. King would have pointed out, hope will come out of this. Dr. King also said that life's most persistent and urgent question is, what are we going to do for others? And as employees of the City of Seattle, you answer that question every day by the work that you do. I am incredibly proud of the service that you provide to the people of this city, service that represents the vision of Dr. King. There are thousands of stories throughout the city about what you do. The firefighters provide life-saving medical care. The city light workers who reduced the utility bills for those who are less fortunate. The police officers who have to deal with tragic events every day. Each of you is embodying the dream of Dr. Martin Luther King. And while you are doing much, we have so much work to do, as recent events have pointed out. I was recently rereading a copy of Dr. King's book, Letters from a Birmingham Jail. Actually, I found it in a box. It actually belonged to my parents. And I was struck by his approach when dealing with those that he was struggling with. I was struck again by it. It was about engagement. It was about nonviolence. It was about a methodology that looked at others as having value, even when you're fighting those others to end discriminatory practices. Today, even as we insist that Black Lives Matter, I do want to say something else that I think if you look at Dr. King's writings, you'll find. We're in a discussion around police in this nation. But if we have that discussion divorced from the other issues that deal with race, then we will change nothing. Because often police officers are at the end of failing systems. That they're at the back end when our education system fails, when 40% of our African American students do not graduate from high school in the city of Seattle. They are at the failing end of a mental health system. They are at the failing end of a criminal justice and prison system. I could go on. So as we engage in trying to take the issues of police reform to the next level, I would urge all of us to do what Dr. King did in significantly more difficult times. There is a time for marching, as scripture says, but there's also a time to talk. In Seattle, it is time to talk. It is time to talk about race, not just among ourselves, but with the police officers and the realities that they face on the streets. Because if we don't engage our police officers, if we simply stigmatize them as a class of people, then as you know, when any class of people is stigmatized, you don't move forward. You don't end discrimination. So I hope that we can have that discussion, that we will march, but we will talk and we will engage. Because the challenges are so great. Before the Great Recession, 43% of African American children in the city of Seattle lived in poverty, an incredible number. Now that number has grown to 54% of African American children who live in poverty. So we have a lot of work to do if we want to change what happens on our streets. And you've been doing it. The great efforts that started before I came here by council members, particularly Council Member Burgess, I shouldn't single any council member out. I should know better than that. By all the council. The work that we completed this year on pre-K, we know that when 3- and 4-year-olds get quality pre-K, the studies are all around the nation, that regardless of race and regardless of income, they will be reading at grade level in fourth grade and they will be graduating. You did something this year that will change lives and change this city and change the things that we are struggling with today. When you raise the minimum wage, and you all worked on this in this city as city employees, we know when we reach $15, the studies show us that the poverty rate will fall from 13% to 9% just by getting to $15. And now we are this year engaged in again trying to change the issues that affect race in this city by dealing with the issue of affordability, making this city a city that is affordable, that people who work here can afford to live here. So the great successes we had last year to deal with issues of inequity, to deal with issues of racial inequality, we need to build on those in the year ahead. So I look forward with all of you in celebrating the memory and work of Dr. King over the next several days, and the Seahawks on Sunday. And then after those celebrations, I look forward as all of us who are in city employees come together and work to once again make Dr. King's dream a reality in the city of Seattle. Thank you so much for making today possible.
All right, thank you, Mr. Mayor. Next up, we're going to have Council President Tim Burgess.
Thank you very much and good morning. Mayor Murray, you're right, the City Council is really strong and we work together well as a team, and that makes you look good. So. Some of the children growing up in our city today face a really tough mountain in front of them when it comes to their education, to their quality of life, to their ability to achieve their full potential. In so many ways, their path will be difficult and crooked. But we can make straight that path. It's not too late. Some young men and women in our city despair because their hopes and dreams have been squished by prejudice, racism, systems and structures that have effectively kept them down. But we have the ability to restore hope. It's not too late. In some neighborhoods of our city, people are tired. Moms and dads work multiple jobs and still can't make ends meet. And some neighborhoods have persistent crime that has been around for decades, and people are afraid. But we can change this reality too. It's not too late. As a city, and especially as a family of public servants, as Mayor Murray has just pointed out, we have taken real practical steps to change these conditions. The creation of the Seattle Preschool Program will give our children a strong and fair start. The passage of paid sick and safe leave means that moms and dads can care for themselves and for their kids and not fear losing their jobs. The new minimum wage law means that families can step out of poverty. And the beginnings of long-needed, sustainable reform of our police department. Dr. King often spoke about the fierce urgency of now, because it's not too late. In his book about the I Have a Dream speech, State Representative Drew Hansen from over on the Olympic Peninsula recounts another time that Reverend King shared his dreams for America, and I'm just going to read a very brief passage. In his Christmas Eve sermon at Ebenezer Baptist Church in 1967, Reverend King delivered another I Have a Dream speech in which he envisioned a future America that God had delivered from poverty as well as from racial discrimination. Reverend King said, "I still have a dream that one day the idle industries of Appalachia will be revitalized and the empty stomachs of Mississippi will be filled. And brotherhood will be more than a few words at the end of a prayer, but rather the first order of business on every legislative agenda." As we honor Dr. King today, let's recommit ourselves to that vision that he cast, and let's make that our first order of business. Thank you.
So that y'all don't rush off so quick. I saw you trying to sit down real quick. I didn't get a chance to give you your certificate. I got you. For the rest of you that come up after you speak, let me walk on down. It ain't going to take me long. Give you your certificate and you can go on to your seat. So one more time, you guys, for Councilmember President. And now we have Councilmember Tom Rasmussen.
Thank you, Isaiah, and thank you to the organizers of today's event and everyone who is joining us today. This really is a wonderful day and a great turnout on the first of what's going to be our annual Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. Unity Day. As Mayor Murray said, these have been very difficult times in our cities, in our country, including Seattle, where people doubt whether justice and fairness can exist in our communities. And people are understandably angry and frustrated under the conditions that they have been living. But today and the next several days, I hope that these are days of reflection on what Dr. King faced and the courage and his tireless work and the work of the men and women of his generation to achieve so much in the face of much greater danger than we've ever thought of and resistance that they experienced. So let this holiday be the time when we replace our anger and our frustration with energy and with a renewed commitment to continue the difficult and necessary work to protect human rights and to work for justice for all. Thank you very much. And several of us have to go to an event at Mount Zion, so if you see several council members and perhaps the mayor leave halfway through, we're not being disrespectful, but we're also going up to Mount Zion for another event.
All right. Next up, we have council member Bruce Harrell.
Thank you for attending the first annual Murray Burgess Love Affair. Oh, you didn't think I was going to let the mayor get away with just giving Burgess his props, did you? I see such a wonderful crowd here. And, you know, we believe in recycling in Seattle. And, you know, Isaiah talked about, you know, he's a stand-up comic, too. Seriously, if you want to see this guy rock and roll, you ought to see him do his thing. He pushes the borderline between his Christian values and humor. But he's hilarious. Our organist pianist here is Lance Randall from Office of Economic Development. See, we recycle. Stefana Sneed works for Seattle Housing Authority. We recycle. And Isaiah said earlier, he said he'd like to take credit for Stefana. And if we've learned one thing under Mayor Murray is what kind of great things could happen when you give credit to the team around you, to the people around you. And if there's one Seahawk lesson that I think makes us special is you see how all of the stars, including the coach, they always are giving other people, the other team, the credit. I keep waiting for that one Seahawk to say, hey, we won because of me. It was all me. They don't do that, the beauty of a team. But I got to tell you, I'm going to take credit for full credit for Stefana Sneed. Okay, I'm going to tell you why. We talked about her mother and father. I was 14 years old. And I had a best friend in high school who happened to be 16. It was only because he had a car, and that was her dad. So he was a senior. I was the trailing sophomore, and we're driving. And so I grew up with her mom, Vita, and her sister, Lynn. And we're stopped downtown, and we're cruising around as kids do. And I saw Lynn and Vita at the bus stop. And I was in the front seat. I was riding shotgun, and Steve said, man, look at those cute girls over there. He says, let's stop and give them a ride. I said, man, that's Lynn and Vita. I'm not giving up my seat for them. You kidding me? And Steve said, her father said, no, let's give them a ride. And I said, oh, man, I rolled down the window. Remember those days? I didn't push a button. I rolled it down. Hey, Lynn and Vita, what are you guys doing? You all want to ride? It was about 30 degrees out there. What were they going to say? I have to give up my seat. Her mother gets in the front seat. And now I think they've been married for, what, 35 years? So I'm responsible for that woman, Stefana Sneed. Thanks for indulging me on that story. I'll be very brief when I say this. For me, the lessons that we are learning from Martin Luther King boil down to one very simple message. He talked about economic development. He talked about multiracial work. He talked about diversity. He talked about empowerment. He talked about many things. But what continues to motivate me, my personal journey, has been what he talked about the most, which is love. To be motivated by love. Now, politicians, we get up there and we talk about environmental sustainability and transportation solutions and urban development, but we don't talk about love. And I know from working with this mayor and this council that what motivates them is a love for people. That when they're talking about universal pre-K or a housing levy or trying to do social service and the amounts of money we invest, that what motivates them is the resounding message that Martin Luther King talks about, which is love. And as city employees, many of whom are here. I got to tell you, my mother and father were city employees, and they worked hard, and they were able to retire in a very robust retirement system. And when I'd come down here at 16, 17, and I hated doing it because I was just coming down to bum some money, they would parade me around and meet this person, meet that person, meet that person. So now when my kids come down there, I'm parading them around and meet this person, meet that person. And I realized when their health failed and when their days became numbered, that it was people they worked with in the city of Seattle who loved them and who they loved. It was their family. So I'm glad that this is the first annual Murray Burgess Love Fest, but I'm also glad that this is the first annual Martin Luther King celebration, because like his message of love, it is sustainable. It is something we can do over and over and over again. So thanks for having me be here, and I'm glad to be a part of the program.
All right, now we are going to have City Attorney Pete Holmes come up.
You know, I was standing here about a year ago, very near the same spot, when I think it was the stranger noticed that it really sucked to be Holmes following after Councilmember Sawant in speaking. So once again, Councilmember Harrell, I want to thank you for maintaining my status as coming. But I do want to just take a minute to give you a personal note about how I believe Dr. King's message of love, in fact, love that would triumph over ignorance and hate, has been a personal message to me. I have to tell you that if you don't know this about me, I grew up in Central Virginia, just about 15 miles from Appomattox, where Lee surrendered to Grant. And I'm a product of a public school system where the official curriculum stressed teaching children Confederate fight songs rather than the peculiar institution of slavery, the real facts. I grew up in a state that trumpeted patriotism, didn't say much at all about secession and taking up arms against the Union, about whether that was an act of treason. And so the point of that is, though, is to say that, you know, my beloved state of Virginia, I think Dr. King has taught me that you love them through that ignorance, through that misinformation, and try to educate them and love them at the same time. It's an explanation, I think, to me, though, why today racism, institutional racism, persists in our society. It's just as clear an explanation to me of why Dr. King's message of love was so difficult in his own lifetime for many to accept. In any event, it is a message of hope. It's one that guides me every day. And I'm grateful to live in Martin Luther King County, and grateful for all of you being here today. Thank you.
As we continue on with the program, as a part of today's celebration, the Office of Arts and Culture sponsored an MLK I Have a Dream youth contest, asking young people in the greater Seattle area to respond to Dr. King's iconic speech and using poetry, essay, spoken word, rap, or music to reflect on where they think we are now in relation to MLK's dream. Today, we're thrilled to have the five youth who wrote the winning entries present their original places, their pieces. Now, I'm not gonna mess up nobody's name. So when I call your first name, come on up. Your job is to give them the rest of the name. You got that? It's a beautiful thing. It's a beautiful thing. First up, this young man, Ivan, is 19 years old and enjoys doing triathlons and learning about other cultures. He is a multilingual and can speak English, Spanish, and French, currently attending the University of Washington. His intended major is aerospace engineering. As part of the College Success Foundation, he helps tutor high school students in areas they need help with, academic or personal. He believes it's important to give back to your community, as one should always remain humble and never forget where one came from. He believes that now more than ever, we need engineers, but not the ones that most people think of. We need problem solvers to help change the world and make it a better place for all. An engineer is someone who sees the best out of a bad situation and makes the most of it. We need to influence the youth to make better decisions and guide them to discover better solutions to the problems we see in our society today. That is why he tries to motivate the youth in his community to do more and want more. Here is the third place winner, Ivan.
Thank you very much for having me today. It's a pleasure to talk to you about what MLK's words mean to me. My piece is titled, King's Call to Action. Martin Luther King's words echo through the streets of every city in the United States, from the origins of the Civil Rights Movement in Birmingham, Alabama, to the skyscrapers of New York City. His words were the dream of a man who believed the U.S. could reconcile its differences between its diverse groups of people. 50 years later, and we look around the same streets that MLK marched in his pursuit of equality, and we see a false sense of accomplishment. We find a blindfolded view of what we want society to be and what it really is. Recent events in Ferguson and the misuse of police power show that times seem to have changed from the time of MLK, but in reality, they have been enhanced. We believe that we have come a long way from the days of segregation, and in a way that is true. We don't see public segregation. We don't see for whites only restrooms or people of color having to give up their seats on the bus. However, although this type of racial discrimination has been somewhat erased, in other ways, it has been increased. How is it that we see a higher percentage of people of color in prisons when they aren't the only ones committing the crimes? How is this possible when the crime rate for whites the same or sometimes higher than that of people of color? Today, we still see the underlying effects of segregation. We still see injustice like the cases in Ferguson and others around the country. We don't need to talk about change. They say politicking is easy, but actions take courage. We need to come together and end the bickering between ourselves if we ever want to achieve the world that MLK envisioned. It's time for action. It's time we work towards seeing a world where hate and oppression are eradicated by love and peace. We need to change the perceptions of how we see one another. And I believe that all starts with the youth. The youth are the future. They'll be the next ones on the front lines that will dictate how the world will function in the coming decades. We need to show them guidance and tell them and the world that we can be united. If we ever wish to see King's dreams become a reality, we need to realize that fighting and violence are not the answer. We need to come together, hand in hand, and work towards a better tomorrow. Thank you.
All right, thank you, Ivan. King's Call to Action, third place winner, congratulations. Our next presenter, Mr. Muhammad, is a 17-year-old and goes to Ingram High School. He lives in a neighborhood called New Holly and has lived there 16 years in the same house. Don't ask, it's a Somali thing, living by your cousins. He is a Muslim and loves playing basketball and writing raps in his journal. It calms him and lets him get away from his troubles in life. He hopefully wants to go to the University of Washington and study computer science, a career that has very few people of color. He wanted to do the MLK I Have a Dream contest because he wanted to show his beliefs on how changed ever since MLK delivered the speech. He hopes you take his rap poem into great consideration. He thanks you and hopes you have a nice day. Fifth place honor.
I don't really have a title for my poem slash rap, but I'm gonna call it Life Goes On. I have a dream, and it's a different type of dream, that everyone will get along and be on the same team. That just because you're black, you won't have to act all thug. And just because you're white, you want to feel like you're above everyone else. Now, I'm not saying that all white people feel like they're on top. Just stop. You're making conclusions. And don't make this some type of seclusion. I'm just trying to show you this messed up illusion that every time someone stereotypes, they are added to the contusion of the world's pride of not being secluded. Now, let me clear all this dire confusion. I'm trying to paint a picture in your mind of Martin Luther King's vision. He took a position that everyone's equal and it doesn't matter what the pigment of your skin is. He decided to not use his sight and use his vision. He never saw the world through an optical illusion. Now that was his decision. He saw the world through lenses, and they weren't prescription. They were lenses of justice. Now let me go back to the subject. It's not very complex. It doesn't matter your sex. This idea is not perplexed. This is not a rant. This is just a call for those who feel the same. This world of wild ideas can never be tamed. If you believe in stereotypes, you should feel ashamed, because all of us are in the same lane. We are not competing against each other. We are competing for this corrupted idea called fame. I know, right? Why is this African kid letting out all his pent-up rage? It's because I believe in this idea of being the same. That's why I'm spilling my heart on this page. We are all equals. This is not a poem slash rap. This is I Have a Dream, the sequel.
Yeah. Go ahead and title that Unstereotyped. I like that. Yeah, Mr. Muhammad. All right, our fourth place honorable mention recipient. She attends Chief Sealth International High School and participates in a writing program with the Bureau of Fearless Ideas. She has green eyes and is from Iraq. All right. She wants to travel the world, starting with France, Brazil, and Italy. Please put your hands together, y'all, for Miss
Yakut.
Yakut. You were supposed to give it to him. Follow the record.
It's an honor to be here, and my piece is titled, I'm a Terrorist. Their words hit like bullets. You stupid, why don't you just take it off? It makes you uglier. She doesn't have hair, that's why she wears it. Although third grade may seem like a faded memory, to me they're still a part clear as pure water in my mind. On the bus, there were three guys who wouldn't get off my case because I wear a hijab, headscarf, and my unique name. Their comments stabbed my 8-year-old heart every time. My ability to speak English was low, making them more powerful than me. Every time I got on the bus, I would try to hide my face, yet they always managed to bring me down, causing tears to sting my eyes. It made me feel like a clueless soldier on a battlefield as they shot their words at me. But they didn't know. Yakut means as precious as a ruby, not something disgusting and ugly like they made it out to be. I wanted to speak those words, to let them rush out of my mouth, breaking their supremacy down, yet they always stayed trapped. Their laughs would echo in my mind as I desperately attempted to create a comeback, but failing, resulting in their victory. Yes, that happened years ago, but if I could have explained the truth, it wouldn't be a bad memory. I would have told them the true meaning of my name, the true reason why I wear a hijab, guide them to the reality of the matter instead of allowing them to stay locked in a jail of dark lies. The bombing of the Twin Towers occurred years ago. However, it generated stereotypes that are still floating around. People assumed Islam was all about violence and war, hatred against anyone who isn't Muslim. Despite the fact I have green eyes and light skin, I've received comments about being a terrorist. Last year, one morning, I was walking inside school when I felt a tug on my backpack. I looked behind me to see a boy from my math class. "Terrorist, terrorist, she's got a gun in her pocket." His voice was like poison to my ears. I pulled my backpack out of his grasp, walking away. My thoughts were blurred. This was the first time that I understood what that word meant. Other times I heard someone being called that were when I was younger and didn't speak English. He just called me a terrorist. Snapping out of it, I headed into class greeting my friends. Conversation initiated normally, but there was still a portion of my brain thinking about what he said. A question popped up. Is that the image portrayed in a lot of people's minds? But I would never hurt anyone. Why would he think that? I've treated him with nothing except kindness. My train of thoughts was interrupted by the bell ringing. I sighed, realizing that being sad about it isn't the solution. I realized that some people will stay in the foggy forest of stereotypes, like the three guys that teased me on the bus. I began packing my things to leave when laughs diverted my attention. It was two guys joking about hairlines. I smiled when one questioned, "Hey, Yakut, do you have hair?" My smile vanished quicker than a snap. "Yes, I have hair," my voice firm and irritated. "Bro, she probably don't even have a hairline." That didn't even make sense. A volcano erupted inside my mind. If they were genuinely unknowing, I wouldn't have been frustrated. But they had a friend who wears a hijab, and she decided to show her hair to them. They knew very well I had hair. They were simply teasing me for the sake of being annoying. A sigh escaped my mouth as I walked out. I recalled another time when someone called me a boy. People assumed information about me without even knowing me. It made my mood transform from a sunny day to a cloudy one. Why don't they ask why I wear it if they honestly didn't know? At the end of the day, these experiences are valuable in a way. Now my heart and emotions can take the pain of being called a terrorist, people asking if I have hair, or even my gender. It made me mature and comprehend how their brains work. My tears aren't triggered so easily, but it will always leave me wondering, why judge someone based on their religion? Why judge someone based on their appearance? Why judge someone based on their ethnicity? Muslims have been treated unfairly for some time now, so I speak not only for myself, but others. People don't face that these assumptions spoken out loud only draw others away from them. If all people who made fun of me had just spared some time to know me, they'd realize that I'm more similar to them than they think. Because truly, the fact is, we're all human.
Yakut, as precious as a jewel. All right. All right. Our second place winner, Aiden Stevens, is a 13-year-old who attends Broadview Thompson K-8 school. She's really into the arts and really loves acting, singing, musical theater, dancing, reading, writing, sewing, knitting, and performing. When do you go to school? She has been in some professional plays, including A Day in the Death of Joe Egg and Thalia's Umbrella at ACT Theater. She also does Taproot Theater Summer Musical Theater Camps. The musicals she's done are Beauty and the Beast, Bye Bye Birdie, Hello Dolly, The Sound of Music, and more. She's gotten a 4-point GPA since sixth grade. She especially loves math, science, and Japanese classes. She's a very outgoing person and loves her family and friends. She also has an interest in fashion and babysits for family and neighbors. Put your hands together for Aiden Steven.
My poem is called There is a Dream That We Share. There is a dream that we share. It is a dream shared by all humankind. A dream that is engraved in the minds of the oppressed and carved in the souls of the abused. A dream that is shared by every human who has felt pain. This is a dream that is with you every waking moment, sleeping moment. It is not the dream you forget when you wake up, because it is the dream of justice and equality. This is the dream that Martin Luther King Jr. led us towards. His words showing us that we are broken as a society, that we need renewal. Martin Luther King Jr. believed in the rights of all people. He knew the dream of justice and equality, and he shared it with us all. He knew the struggle of oppression and defeat, but he taught us never to stop. Now we will never stop, because there is a dream that we share that brings us to strive to achieve the justice and equality and peace that all people deserve. The acceptance where someone is able to stand up and say, I'm gay, and take pride in that. The ability to march and sing through the streets protesting for what you believe in. And the change where we can have our first black president, and we celebrate that. And there's a dream that we share that causes us to hope, because we know that there is still more work to be done. While people march and throw up their hands to say, hands up, don't shoot, where we can make a change about police brutality by saying, I can't breathe, because black lives matter, and that's a fact. There's a dream that we share that makes us long for justice and equality. We know our voices matter, so we will march singing, we shall overcome, because we will overcome someday. There is a dream that we share.
Thank you, Aiden. We know Aiden probably got to get back to babysitting or knitting or something. We know she can't stay, we know that. And last but not least, our first place winner. Again, I call it an honor and a pleasure to introduce this young lady who is one of my own, Adelia Estelle Scott. Adelia is 19, lives in the Central District, and attends the Seattle Vocational Institute Cosmetology Program. Art all around interests her, from soul music to hip-hop, journalism, photography, jewelry making, and spoken word poetry. She's been writing since elementary school, wanting to be like her mother, the very well-known Felicia V. Loud, well-known singer and actress in the state of Washington. Her goal in life is to give voice to those who have been silenced or believe they won't be listened to. She wants to save and love a little girl like so many women in her life have done for her. First place winner, y'all, Miss Adelia Scott.
My poem is called Sometimes I Dream. Sometimes I find myself dreaming, yet I'm wide awake, staring through reality, screaming, this must be a mistake. 50 years later, we still live by the same four words of the same speech. We try to walk the same walk. We even try to mimic the way he preached. Yet we fall through on the follow through. Let us not wallow in the valley of despair. Who am I and who are you? For 400 years, our ancestors fought in captivity. 400 years used and abused. 146,000 days, 6,083 hours unable to protect you. 150 years removed, tell me what's new. Last night I had a dream. As I stood in the middle of the nation's capital, I began to scream, shots have been fired. Over the balcony's railing, Dr. King. 10 shots in the middle of the neighborhood streets, Michael Brown. 2 shots in the park, Tamir Rice. 1 shot in the dark, Trayvon Martin. 50 shots on his wedding day, Sean Bell. 1 bullet through a sleeping 7-year-old girl's head, Ayanna Jones. Walmart customers riddled with shell casings and bullets, Sean Crawford. Guns mistaken as tasers, Oscar Grant. 7 shots in his back, 4 shots through his chest, Kamani Gray. Hands cuffed behind his back, yet they still managed to attack. 1 bullet through his chest, Victor White III. The police are on a rampage. The color black is the target. Martin was telling me a dream. As I woke up and he told me all the evils he'd seen. Malcolm handed me a pencil and told me to succeed by any means necessary. As I begin to write, the notebook began to bleed. How many heroes must we lose just because we want to be proud and free? Martin Luther King, Malcolm X, Fred Hampton, Huey P. Newton, Tupac Shakur, Sam Cooke, Marvin Gaye, Mega Evers. Last night I had a dream. As I witnessed them assassinate not only the man, but his character, I begin to weep. Last night I had a dream. As I begin to speak, they begin to choke me with the words, young, dumb, ignorant, and naive. Last night I had a dream. As I stood back and watched them march, unable to participate because I, in fact, envisioned violent thoughts. As I attempted to cash a check given to me by the nation that came back with the words stamped, insufficient funds. I am not satisfied, nor will I ever be satisfied as they continue to mask lies with excuses conceived in the darkness. This morning, I had a dream that maybe it all isn't as bad as it seems, that maybe all the suffering is actually awakening, yet all the suffering is turning into heart-aching pain, and I'm beginning to get angry, and I'm beginning to become numb. Today, I have a dream that my brothers will take their place as kings, and that my sisters will realize they are once again queens, that we will first learn to again love each other, that our hair is in fact our crown and not our weakness, that our skin is as pure as coffee, and that our smiles shine like elephant tusk, uncut diamonds, pure gold. Last night I had a dream that again we valued our culture and listened as one another spoke. Last night I had a dream that my call for action became beautiful pleas, became songs, became lyrics for peace. We shall overcome. We shall overcome. We shall overcome. Deep in my heart, I do believe that with this faith, we will be able to work together, to pray together, to struggle together. No longer will we turn the channel and not see. No longer will we Bobby Martin's dream. I say to you today and my friends, Even though we face the difficulties of today and tomorrow, I still have a dream. I will forever have a dream. I have a dream that this nation will rise up. And if America is to become a great place, this must be true. Last night I had a dream that the lifespan of black children was no longer cut short, that we didn't need to wear our deceased upon our t-shirts, that we didn't need to explain to them why our lives matter. And if it's necessary, then listen to my dream, because last night I had a dream. And to some, it may be similar to Martin King's. To me, I just find myself dreaming. All I ever wanted was justice. All I ever dreamed for was peace. Last night I had a dream. Sometimes I find myself dreaming.
Let's keep that going for all the participants who participated, all of the winners. We want to thank the Office of Arts and Culture. I love you and I'm proud of you, ladies. Wow. Wow. Ladies and gentlemen, it's time for our keynote speaker. The very beautiful Shakti Butler, PhD, filmmaker and founder and president of the World Trust, is a dynamic educator in the field of diversity and racial equity. Dr. Butler engages audiences with participatory keynotes and workshops, often using clips from her films. Known as a catalyst for the change, she is hired by organizations seeking broader support for their diversity and inclusion goals. Ladies and gentlemen, please put your hands together for the very beautiful, I haven't seen her in so long, Ms. Shakti Butler.
Somebody gonna get in trouble. A little bit low. Is there somebody who's adjusting these things, or do you want me to try to do it? Thank you. I don't know whether it's morning or afternoon now, so I'll just say hello, everybody. How are y'all doing? Like Josephine Howell and Marvin Gaye said, what's going on? It's been a very full morning, hasn't it? So it's really an honor for me to be here for this gathering, to remember a great man. And we're remembering that great man as community. But I want to say something about remembering. Remember, to put all the parts together to make a whole. And so when we're in the process of remembering, and we're in the process of remembering as community, we are sharing some common attitudes. And that common attitude that we're talking about today is freedom. So we're going to hear a little bit of song about freedom. You'll know the song, so feel free to sing along or hum.
We who believe in freedom cannot rest. We who believe in freedom cannot rest until it comes. We who believe in freedom cannot rest. We who believe in freedom cannot rest until it comes. Until the killing of black men, black mothers, sons, is as important as the killing of white men, white mothers, sons. We who believe in freedom cannot rest.
Let me hear you.
We believe in freedom.
We believe that freedom can carry us.
That which touches me most is that I had a chance to work with people, passing on to others that which was passed on to me. We who believe in freedom and that freedom can carry us.
Sing it with us, come on.
We who believe in freedom and that freedom can carry us. To me,
so we can't rest because we're not there yet, are we? We're working on it though, real hard. And I think for me, it's really important to remember to make whole the whole man who Dr. Martin Luther King was. So often we narrow him down to just the I have a dream speech. But in fact, Martin Luther King was a radical. And why was he radical? What made him a radical? He was a revolutionary. A revolutionary is someone who believes in change. And radical is when you have to turn the beast over. You have to turn the whole thing over and really examine what is going on. So Martin Luther King provided us with analysis. He provided us with wisdom, and he provided us a methodology which was being firmly engaged in the power of love and economic reprisal. Because people don't change so easily. I don't. Do you? It takes a certain kind of commitment to want to change. So if we're going to learn from his vision, if we're going to learn from his insights, if we're going to learn from his analysis, and if we're going to learn from his devotion, we have to study his words. When we don't study our history, what happens? We repeat the same errors over and over and over again. So, I don't know what freedom means to you. I can talk about what freedom means to me, but this is not about me. It's about all of us. Dr. West, Cornell West, has written a book called The Radical King. And I would like to say you should check it out. What he's done is he's taken a compilation of Dr. Martin Luther King's speeches, of which he gave many, and the books that he wrote, and distilled them down into a really clear portrait of the fullness of the man. So when we talk about Dr. King, we don't necessarily think of him as a radical. That's not high on our list. But with his insistence on nonviolence, his Southern humility, his Christian bearing, and his soaring yet measured oratory, King never cast stones. He never cast stones. And he never cast firebombs, real or symbolic. But underneath his sober exterior lay the passion of a revolutionary who seethed at what he saw as the future of Western civilization, Western capitalism, and not only racism, because definitely racism, but poverty, militarism, and empire building. These hard truths we must look at, we must understand. And although most closely associated with the civil rights movement, King saw that struggle as intertwined with economic inequality and American foreign policy, all of which he spoke about or wrote about throughout his life, needed deep attention. Democratic participation. Cornell West points to the fundamental commitment of King is to a radical love of humanity, and especially of the poor and the working people. And that radical love led him to a radical analysis that talks about power and domination and oppression. Martin Luther King's last year of his life was very, very intense. Do you know what happened to Martin Luther King the last year of his life? He gave a speech at Riverside Church, right up the block from where I grew up. And in that speech, he talked about what it means to move through issues of domination and bring them together. And he most specifically talked about the Vietnam War. And he got a lot of press back from the press and from his own people. And he still persisted in telling the truth. So when I think about who Martin Luther King was, I ask myself, what is my level of courage? What is my level of persistence? How often am I willing to speak the truth? And how often am I willing to put myself on the line for my brothers and my sisters? What do I do if I say that I believe firmly in compassion, but I don't hold people to accountability? That's not really compassion. It's just this kind of funny, you know, double-edged sword that we find ourselves having to walk on. In a speech that he gave on April 4th, 1967, called A Time to Break the Silence, and this is a speech that he did at Riverside Church, he said this about the Vietnam War. Oh, you double-sided it. I was wondering why I couldn't figure out where I was. I'm like, I see. You know, but I'm an old blind lady, and so I'm like trying to, where was I going with this? Okay, thank you. I was like, phew. Okay. So let me backtrack just a bit. So Dr. Cornel West, who was talking to you about before, who just released this book, this is how he described Dr. King, and I found it to be really interesting. He said, Martin Luther King Jr. was one of the greatest organic intellectuals in American history. His unique ability to connect the life of the mind to the struggle for freedom is legendary. And in this book is his last grand expression of his vision that he put forward, the most prophetic change to challenge the powers that be and his most progressive program for the wretched of the earth. When we study Dr. King's words, it's important, and I do believe we need to study his words. We need to study the words of great beings who have experiences that they can pass on to us, that we can imbibe and fold into how we live our lives, so that we're in alignment with the best of who we are. When we study his words, we have to understand that his passages are really retelling some of the most dramatic episodes of the civil rights struggle. When I was growing up, and I should tell you that I grew up in Harlem, right near Riverside Church, I remember so clearly when I was 8 years old and I opened up Jet magazine, I saw a picture that horrified me. It was the body of Emmett Till. I remember screaming at eight, not being able to take in the immense brutality that had happened to this young man. And of course, I had no language. I had no way to comprehend. How could human beings do this to a boy? How could they dismantle his body in the way that they did? What kind of hatred was seething inside of our society? When I was 16, Dr. Martin Luther King gave his speech at the March on Washington. Now, my daddy wouldn't let me go. I wanted to go. But he wouldn't let me go because he thought that there would be rioting, that I would get hurt. And so he wouldn't let me go. But I remember watching and seeing what he said and the people who were there, and it changed my entire life. I wanted to be like that. What was Martin Luther King's power? It's the very thing that got him killed. His ability to bring people together across divides, to unite people of many faiths and many colors and many hues. We can do that. We can do that every day. That is our job, and that is his legacy. He said during the speech that he gave at Riverside Church years later, "A time comes when silence is betrayal. That time has come for us in relation to Vietnam. And the truth of these words is beyond doubt, but the mission to which they call us is a most difficult one. Even when pressed by the demands of inner truth, men do not easily assume the task of opposing their government's policies, especially in time of war. Nor does the human spirit move without great difficulty against all the apathy of conformist thought within one's own bosom and in the surrounding world. Moreover, when the issues at hand seem as perplexing as they often do in the case of any dreadful conflict, we are always on the verge of being mesmerized by uncertainty. But we must move on." If we take out the Vietnam War and we look at the basis of what he's saying here, are not those words applicable to where we are right now? That we are living in times of uncertainty, but we must move on. And that for me is where hope lies. It's sort of like being in a relationship. Like, I'm married to this really fine, wonderful man. But what I love most about our relationship is I trust that when we hit a barrier, we're going to work through it. We're going to move on. And we as a nation have to look at what it is we need to do. We need to speak up. We need to tell the truth to ourselves and to one another. And we must move on. Last night, my friend Darlene Flynn, who works for the city, many of you know her, she's right back there, she spoke at the Office for Civil Rights talking about the history of Black Lives Matter and how this movement is forcing people to look at injustice. And the hashtag broke the mainstream silence. This is a quote from what she said. Flynn also said, "There are so many silences to be broken." So if I'm to challenge myself, and I'm to challenge all of us, where are the silences that you're holding that must be broken? What is it you're not speaking up about because you're afraid? Where are the places that we keep ourselves small because we don't know what the uncertainty of the future will bring if we speak up? He clearly gives us a mandate to step into our full greatness as human beings. It's part of what Martin Luther King made so available to all of us. He modeled that in everything that he did. When I was a teenager, a little bit older than 16, 17, 18, I used to go hear Malcolm X speak. Malcolm X spoke not too far from where my house was. And there was one thing that both of those men had in common. It was love. The love that I felt pour off of Malcolm X, which the press never talked about, was palpable. And in the same way that Martin Luther King grew and expanded and deepened his mission in life, so did Malcolm X. When Malcolm X made his pilgrimage to Mecca, and he saw people of all colors worshiping together, it opened his heart. When Martin Luther King saw suffering among all people, it opened his heart. Today, we're in a place where we can have our hearts opened. But we have to feel what it is that's going on that is unjust in order to take that stand for justice. And we can't really afford to fool around very much, very longer. If you're interested in justice, you have to look at how oppression and domination play themselves out in terms of how we deal with the earth, how we deal with all forms of oppression, how we deal with each other, and how we deal with ourselves. We are disconnected. We are disconnected from ourselves, and we're disconnected from each other, and we're disconnected from the earth. And we're so busy, aren't we? We're so very busy, we don't have time to stop and realize what is important in this life. So Dr. King's brilliance was that he was able to hold paradox, that more than one thing is true at a time, and he was a radical thinker. And this mainstream perception of him, drawn from just the few lines of, "I have a dream," is not enough. It wasn't the American dream as it's generally espoused. It was a dream that all human beings, especially poor and working people, be treated with dignity. The American dream says, "I can engage in upward mobility and live the good life." King's dream was fundamentally Christian, but his commitment to radical love and everything to do with his commitment to Jesus of Nazareth, and his dream had everything to do with community. It was a we consciousness that included everyone. Where do you exclude? Where do I exclude? Where do we embrace? Where do we get stuck in being right? And you know, if the world worked the way you thought it should, it would all be okay, wouldn't it? Because we tend to be with people who are like us. But Dr. King said, no, that's not good enough. We have to do more. And his fundamental commitment to this radical love of humanity was something that led him to this radical analysis of power and domination and oppression. And here's where some of his greatest teachings are. Some of the work that I do around race is directly drawn from my being exposed to some of the statements that Dr. King made. We don't necessarily think systemically. But if I'm to talk to you about systems of oppression, systems of racialization, gender, class, LGBTQ, all kinds of folks, Native folks, brown, if we talk about that stuff, you'll see that the system offers the same frame. So I'm going to share this frame with you because I think it's something important to hold on to. The system of inequity is embedded in history and culture and identity. It is moved by power and economics. It has internal components and external components. And all of these things, like any system, are going on at the same time. If we don't understand the system, if we don't have a deeper analysis of a system, we cannot change it. We cannot change it, but change it we must. In King's last book that he wrote, where do we go from here? From community or chaos? Which one of those ways are we going to go? His wife wrote, Coretta Scott King, in this book, he piercingly revealed the cause of our national discord, placing it squarely on the ingrained white racism of American society. He made discrimination and poverty the central focus of his attacks. And she goes on to say that a year later, spending nearly $1 million, the National Advisory on Civil Disorders came to the very same conclusion. So let me break that down. We often can't have the conversations we need to have because we don't want to be offensive, or we don't know how to have them. But we were born into a history that we did not create. We were born into a system that we did not create. But once we see how the inequities are playing themselves out, the disproportionate effects of poverty and poor healthcare and poor education and the prison pipeline and all of those things that are happening, once we notice that they're happening, we have to ask why and what can I do? Because it's not about us as individuals. It's about a system that is designed to perpetuate itself. Do you understand what I'm saying? It's not about white people per se. It's not about black and brown people per se. It's about the systemic churning out of inequities that we are all bound up in. If you go to school here in the United States, and you look at whose pictures were on the wall about who is important, you're learning about power. When you watch television and you see what's on TV, you're learning about placement. And so the system really does have lots of components that keep us asleep. Racism is a philosophy that is based on a contempt for life. It is the arrogant assertion that one race is the center of value before which other races must kneel in submission. It is the absurd dogma that one race is responsible for all progress in history. These are King's words. This is what he spoke. But he was about brotherhood and sisterhood. So if that's confusing, we have to ask ourselves, why does that seem contradictory? He says, King does, that we as a nation must undergo a radical revolution of values. When machines and computers and profit motives and property rights are considered more important than people, the giant triplets of racism, materialism, and militarism become forms of violence that exist in a vicious cycle. They are interrelated, all-inclusive, and stand as barriers to his goal, our goal, which is to create beloved community. Beloved community where everyone has a chance to shine, where we accept that invitation to step into our greatness and do what is challenging. Dr. West talks about King's militant nonviolence. He goes back to radical love. You don't begin by dehumanizing those who are dehumanizing you, because it contributes to this cycle of dehumanization in the world. And you're right. It takes unbelievable spiritual courage, moral fortitude, to engage in militant nonviolence. To put it another way, Martin King was an extremist of love. We live in a world where people are fearful of extremism, but King would say he was always trying to keep the flow of love in place. In that sense, he turned the world on its head. We all have work to do, every single one of us, internally, externally. White folks have work to do, people of color have work to do, we have ways that we perpetuate stereotypes, we have ways that we dehumanize one another, and to recognize it is the first step. My friend Robin DiAngelo, who's the Director of Equity and Inclusion at Seattle Senior Services, was last night at the same forum that Darlene was at. And she said that while some may consider racism a thing of the past, images and culture further a new racism. She cited a phone app that shows users how to avoid sketchy neighborhoods. Have you seen that phone app yet? It's drawing a lot of attention. It tells you where not to go. I just came back from Costa Rica. I had the same thing. Don't go to these places because people will steal from you. I went to South Africa. It was the same thing. Don't roll down your windows and talk to these people because they're trying to rip you off. Don't go here, go there. This fear that's generated among us is devastating. And she is really a beautiful and amazing person, as is my friend Darlene, and bold. So what do we do? What do we do? We have to connect the dots among all of the struggles for equity that we don't get to hear about, and the struggle for humanity, and make visible all of the good work that's actually happening right now. There's so many people who are doing amazing things, growing food gardens, you know, fixing up schools. I just read about a teacher in Boston who won $150,000, and she's giving all of that money to her school. Amazing. Amazing people doing good things. We have to heal. We have to attend to our healing. Everybody suffers from the isms. White people suffer. Brown and black people suffer. Everyone suffers. Being cut off from one another is a form of suffering. Equity needs to become embedded in our culture and into our collective conscience. It has to be popularized. Goodness has to be popularized instead of the negative all the time. We must learn how to ask good questions. Good questions. Good questions at the right time can move mountains. But we don't ask questions. We try to get the answers, but we don't really talk to each other. This morning, I got a video text from my husband. And it was three of my grandchildren, I have five, from 2 to 22. And they were on the phone saying, "Good morning, Grammy." It melted my heart. But this is who the work is for. Beyond us, it's for our children and our children's children and their children. We have to make the world a place that is transparent, where we can tell the truth, when we don't have to be afraid to say, "Hey, let's work on this over here. We could do this together." We have to change. That is our job. And that is the legacy of Dr. Martin Luther King. So I want to thank you for being here. You've had a long program today, and it was filled with a lot of good things. I really enjoyed myself. Thank you so much. And thank you for listening to these words. For me, hope lies in telling the truth. It lies in us being brave. It lies in us being strong. It lies in us being cohesive. And it lies in our ability to study the words of great beings. Have a great day.